just quickly, I'm not going to the first few slides. This is all explaining the whole thing about LAP, and I'm sure you're also seeing around LAP your beautiful place. This is basically the canal network of LAP. As you know, LAP has the two main canals, which is the water canal and commercial canal, both of which are flowing actually from west to east, so actually flow into the backwaters. There has been attempts to kind of link it to the sea, but they have not worked because of accretion of sand. And you have this network of the smaller sub canals which actually drain into the main canal, so that is the overall network of it. As you saw in the video, this is a present scenario, but at the same time, LAP also has a lot of, so LAP lost its prominence as a port, and that is when the canals started losing its importance also. But finally, now LAP has gained prominence in tourism. So that is a new economic main thrust in LAP besides COIR and all that. So this, as you know, there was this major, how this whole thing started was actually as a campaign to address the solid waste issue of LAP. Once that was tackled, we moved on into addressing the canal rejuvenation. So basically it was decided that there has to be, so the winter school which IIT actually conducted in 2017, the main outcomes of it, when we realized that two things have to be taken hand in hand. One, of course, we have to find out sustainable technical interventions are needed. But at the same time, the other most important factor that we realized is that right now the canals don't have any use in the everyday life of people. Earlier they used to be navigable canals, so they had a purpose. Now nobody has any purpose for the canal, so that's why everyone kind of leaves it as dumping places. So we said unless and until we kind of bring in some more activities towards canal banks, or kind of make people feel happy about going near the canals or spending some time near it, there will not be that sense of ownership to maintain it and keep it well. So we thought both these things, so bring back the concept of life along water's edge also should be part of this whole intervention is what we thought, especially because LAP has a tourism thing. And of course, as we said, the main decisions were also that LAP does need a decentralized approach, as I earlier said. And the significant thing is that often when you talk about cleaning of the canals, all these years, what has been happening is that the main two canals get a lot of attention because that's where the tourists come and go and all that. So as you can also see, there is beautification, there is kind of embankments built, there is a kind of almost every year there is some kind of cleaning happening and all that. But what is happening is that unless and until you tackle the pollution in the smaller canals, you cannot completely clean the main canals. So that was one significant decision that we had taken. And we realized that if you have to kind of clean up the smaller canals, it means addressing the liquid and solid waste together, and also address a stormwater issue, because ultimately all these canals are stormwater drains. Because especially in a place like Kerala, where you have 3000 millimeters plus rainfall, the face of the canal in monsoons and during dry times are completely different actually. And of course, to make it sustainable, we need to kind of build and do the institution building, and we have to get people's participation, etc., etc. So this is, as we said, it actually houses about 100 houses. There's a small colony there. There are a few private sector institutions, etc. So we did the whole lot of initial studies. We did physical surveys of the entire canal stretch, tried to find out what is the kind of activity that is happening in the catchment of the canals. We did our water sampling and testing and all that. We did socio-economic surveys. So all that took, these were all images of how we took the flow measurements. So you take it at different times of the day, different times of the week, etc. The quality also, you have to actually take it at different times of the day, different times of the week, and analyze it during summer, during during rainy time, etc. So this process happened, and we learned a lot by interacting with the local community also. So all that, and we finally came to an understanding, came to a conclusion that the pilot phase that we took, actually the total canal is about 2 kilometers. We took only about 500 meters of the last stretch of the canal. So there is about 1.5 kilometers upstream which we have not touched as part of the pilot phase. So we realized that when it actually comes to a pilot phase, there's about 200 cubic meters of water, and another 70 cubic meters gets added in our pilot area. We also monitored all the wastewater samples in different places and all that, and we came to certain values of BOD, COD. We also did the water sample, the drinking water samples from both the municipal supply, as well as we took a lot of water samples from open wells and bore wells and all that, just to understand. And it's unfortunate that even the municipal supply water was found to be having E. coli and all that in many places, which is, I think that's another debate altogether. So then we actually listed out what are the kind of interventions that we need to do, and we actually listed out about 11 specific interventions that one needs to tackle, and this we feel is probably a replicable thing for every canal shed, at least in Alappi. So we actually listed it out like this. One is, of course, the works related to the cleaning, because all these sub canals, they have never been cleaned perhaps in years or decades. So the first thing, of course, is to clean the existing canal. So there is a lot of solid waste accumulation in all these canals. You have to desilt it a bit because there is a lot of silt that has also accumulated. Then the second aspect is to find out the liquid waste hotspots. Like, you know, there are, what we mean by hotspots is bulk generators of wastewater, not just like a single house and all that. Like, for, and you have these kind of hotspots in both the public realm as well as in the private sector. In the public realm, it might be a market, it might be an economically weaker section housing, it might be an abattoir, or it might be a government hospital or something like that, which of course has to be the responsibility of the civic administration to address it. So identifying hotspots, liquid waste hotspots in the public realm is one thing. Identifying liquid waste hotspots in the private sector was the other thing, because those you can actually get the pollution control board to police and enforce the norms, because anybody more who's generating more than 10,000 liters of water is today expected to kind of set up their own treatment system, which often doesn't happen, but that is a matter of policy. Similarly, you have to identify hotspots of solid waste generation also. So we sometimes, in our own pilot area, there was one catering company who was actually catering to about 1,000 people and all during their season. So there is a whole lot of liquid waste as well as solid waste that they generate. So you have to get hold of them. And the same thing is there in the public realm also. Like, for instance, a market or an abattoir actually generates a bulk of solid waste also. So you have to identify solid waste hotspots in the public sector, or solid waste hotspots in the private sector. Then the sixth aspect of it is drainage hotspots, because as we also understood when we were studying, and what happens is that all these canals, as I said, were actually stormwater drains at some point of time. But over the years, unfortunately, there has been a lot of indiscriminate encroachments. There have been new drains which have been added up. There have been drains which have closed. And most of these are unfortunately very, very badly designed or detailed. So you might have a canal which is 2 meter wide at upstream. When it comes to the middle, it's probably just becomes 60 centimeters, and then it again widens out. And all these things are unfortunately so much there. So what happens is that they create drainage bottlenecks. So some areas perpetually become prone to flooding. So whatever you're trying to do with your canal revisionation, you have to attend to the drainage hotspots also. Then the seventh aspect is attending to the household level wastewater, because as I said, we realized that in Alappi, even to kind of combine a cluster of houses, because generally in Kerala you have a system where everyone owns at least if you're talking about middle class and upper middle class, people may have at least 3 cents of land or 4 cents of land, and they have their own house. So even if you're trying to combine about 40-50 houses, by the time you kind of run the line and take it to a cluster level, one thing is that you don't have the land to put up a treatment system there. Second thing is that even by then, by the time you reach about 100-150 meters, you have to take your pipe down to 1.5 meter below ground level, where you're already hitting the water table. So it becomes very complicated to put a pump chamber there and pump it, and then who maintains that pump, and all these things becomes issues. So we finally decided that it might be worthwhile exploring household level treatment systems for both black and grey water. So this is one thing that we are right now racking our brains on, how to actually approach it, make it economically viable, how to go for prefabrication, etc., etc. So that is happening. So with all these interventions, once all these seven initial aspects are taken care of at the source, we feel that by the time the wastewater reaches the main canal, it would already have been treated to at least 70%. This our our assumption actually. So then you only have to give the final treatment at the mouth of the bigger canals. So we suggest that there can be like constructed wetlands and all that, or even in some cases you can think of having floating wetlands in the water itself, which will just do the final treatment of water before it joins the main water gate. Then together with it, as I said, we also have to bring in conscious measures to bring in that sense of ownership. So we said, while we are actually tackling the rejuvenation of the canal, let us bring in good lighting, good access to it, because often it is the older people or the children who have time to actually spend near the canals, and very often these canals have steep steps and all going down. So we have nice ramps and safe walkways along the main canal, so that people are encouraged to kind of take that, and even for tourists actually, because actually each of these stretches about 3 kilometers. So if you can create nice beautiful walkways along these canals and have shops on the sides of it, now that bring in, and you have to give good lighting, good walk bridges and all that, so bring in those kind of beautification and sense of ownership. And the 10th aspect of it, which is very important, is to the people's participation. So one of the things that we have, as I said in the video also, this campaign activities are also happening simultaneously as we are working on the technical interventions. So we expect that the canal committees will be kind of empowered to, once the systems are done, to kind of take care of it and kind of do the upkeep and maintenance of each of these interventions. And finally, along with this, we are also trying to urge the government to kind of set up the first fecal sludge treatment plant. So these are the 11 interventions that we are trying to work on the pilot phase, and which we feel will be a kind of a replicable approach for each of the canal sheds. So as I said, in terms of the canal level cleaning, the first thing is, this is how the canals were actually looking when we actually took over the pilot phase. This mouth of the canal was so choked with solid waste. We actually decided that you have to do the cleaning before monsoons, because that's a time when the flow in the canals is minimum, because you don't have storm water. So many stretches of the canal were actually practically dry during the non-monsoon time, because they only had a little bit of wastewater flowing into it. So some stretches we could do it manually, some stretches we used with small equipment standing on the side of it. In some areas we could actually use a small JCB to do the cleaning and desilting. And the final mouth of the canal, we actually used a little more sophisticated equipment to kind of water jet it and take all the waste and remove it and all that. So finally, the pre-monsoons, when we actually cleaned that whole stretch, that itself you can understand that it makes a big difference, because the flow improves, the sense of, and we have realized that once we have done it, at least over the last 6 months after cleaning, or 6 months at least, we would say there has been at least 65 to 70% awareness created. I can't say that people have totally stopped dumping waste. There are still pockets where people come and throw, but it has come down considerably, because people feel that there is something going to happen here. You know. Then the second thing is, as was said in the video, once it is clean, we have decided that we put these screens at every 250 meters approximately, and define a canal committee, which will be the people who are actually staying in the 250 meters. So these actually become like an area, I mean, defining their area of intervention. Plus it also helps to kind of trap any trash that comes into it. So only that stretch they have to take care of. And we are also going to put up CCTV cameras at each of these screens, so that you get to know whether it is somebody who's kind of dumping it into it or whatever like that. So that is one more intervention that we are doing. So you can see with the first screen, when the monsoons came, you had the trash kind of collecting here, which had to be just removed. Then, as was said, there is also this issue that we did, that often what happens is, if the road and then the canal just dipping down. So even if your canal is clean, if there is trash put on the road, once there is, with just some sweeping or something, all this waste can go into it. So we are suggesting, thinking of putting these gabions, which are like open jointed stoneworks. So these are like open jointed stoneworks, which will permit the water to flow through, but the solids will be left in the roads. Then there is a thing of embankments. Some of the embankments might have been broken and all that, so we kind of rebuild and strengthened the embankments wherever it was needed. So those were the kind of multiple interventions at the canal level. Then the public sector hotspot that we have, which you will again be seeing, is we had one colony of about 52 houses. What happened was that initially, when this colony is about 30 years old or something. So when it was initially built, they were not provided any toilets. So there was a community toilet that they were using. But as you know, people, nobody likes really using a community toilet. So over the years, almost 30 or more of them had built some kind of a toilet in their house. But of course, these are all people who have just about 2 cents of land. So their house and the toilet is like really small, and they don't have any kind of treatment system. They are just given leach pits, and often, and they don't have piped water supply. So they were kind of putting a small bore well near it. So it was all like completely unhygienic setup, particularly during the monsoons. So we thought that if we have to kind of address their issue, we have to first give them also proper toilets. So the project is actually, we are doing them new toilets for at least 35 of them who don't have any kind of toilets, or very toilets which are in poor condition. Some of them have reasonably good toilets, so we thought that we'll retain it, we'll just pipe it out. And we realized that it's not possible to just give a toilet alone, because your bathing water and your washing water and your kitchen wastewater are also important quantums of wastewater. All that was just going to a common drain, so we thought, let us pipe that also. So this is the work on the toilets. We actually, these are the kind of houses that we had, so we gave them small toilet facilities. These are all completed now, so they have nice neat looking toilets and a bathing space for each of them. This was an open drain into which they were kind of letting off all their wastewater. So, and in some of the existing toilets, we just upgraded it for them, because there was no space otherwise. So this was just improvements to that. And we also gave each of the houses a small space where they could actually wash their clothes and wash their kitchen water and their kitchen vessels and all that, and pipe that. So once that is done, from every house, there is a manhole into which all your wastewater goes. And we suggested that at the mouth of this manhole, where it joins the main line, we are going to give a grating, so that if there is any solid waste, like somebody is kind of dumping, then that gets trapped at their own house. So if there is something problematic, you have to take care of it at your own house level, because the moment it gets into the main line, then nobody is going to take care of it. So after each of these houses, so each of these houses will have a manhole like this with a grating. And from there, it goes to a common main line. And we intend to completely do away with that open drain and pave the whole area. So there will be only storm water that is flowing through it, and it becomes completely a clean space. And then we plan to provide them a DWAT system, which will treat about 15,000 liters of water. That work is happening. So this is the construction of the DWATs in progress. Now it is almost done. This was just taken a couple of days back. So it's a DWAT system. And then we are deciding that once all this is done, then their community toilet no longer has any function. So we suggested that it's a fairly good building actually. So we suggested that why not convert that space into a small reading room or something like that for the students, because it becomes a usable space rather than just getting abandoned and not used of. Then we again, this is for the private sector hotspots. We said that let it be policed and set up. The drainage hotspots to be attended, as I said. The demonstrative single household interventions which are happening right now. The fine tuning of the solid waste management is happening through the Canal P campaign, and we are getting the canal committees to take responsibilities of improving the solid waste management systems. We will also be now getting, once all these things are done, we'll be getting into setting up this constructed wetlands at the mouth of the main canal. These are images which I've shown you earlier. The overall beautifications, we are also trying to bring in a lot of graffiti on the walls, which will give positive messages on the whole concept of decentralization, etc., etc., good lighting and all that. The fecal sludge treatment plant, as I said. These were some of the meetings we had for formation of the canal committees. So there was a minister himself who came and kind of motivated, and I think 3 of the committees have already been formed now, and slowly we are expecting them to get more active into taking ownership of their canals. So eventually we feel that if this kind of a system happens, then by say 2020 we feel that Alappuzha would have cleaned all its 17 canal sheds, about 250 kilometers of the sub canals and all that, and we can set up in position all the treatment systems at the individual building level, and also bring in a lot of vibrancy on the edge of the waters, bring in a lot of art, etc., etc. And if it works for IIP, then we feel it can work for any of the, there are any number of small towns which are on the banks of the Vembanad Lake. So the ultimate vision is that if we can show a good demonstration in IIP, then it can kind of take to so many of the other small towns also, and we can hope that the whole of Vembanad Lake ecosystem can be improved eventually. Thanks.
Hope you enjoyed the lectures. So what did we learn this week? We looked at different models of centralized and decentralized wastewater treatment systems. While Professor Kalber deliberated upon the conventional model, Architect Letha explained the process of planning and execution of a DWOT system. Let us run through the interventions which were proposed as well as their current status. The community toilet in the colony, which catered to the need of the 50 households, was converted into a library cum reading room, and individual toilets were constructed for each of the households. A proper connected system was also established to transport the wastewater generated in each of the households to the DWOTS plant. The DWOTS plant was designed and constructed by Inspiration Kochi and Consortium for DWOTS Dissemination, CDD Bangalore. In addition to these measures, it is important to ensure that the subcanal remains clean. To trap the solid waste which find its way to the subcanal, screens were placed at regular intervals in the canal. Additionally, 10 CCTV cameras were also placed along the subcanal to monitor the same and to identify people who were disposing of solid waste into the canal and consequently polluting it. The walls adjoining the subcanals were cleaned and painted upon, thus creating an aesthetic environment around the canals. This may deter potential polluters from dumping the waste into the canals. These interventions have not only managed to mitigate the problem of liquid waste management, operation and maintenance of each DWOT system, as well as upkeep and management of the public library, can provide employment to local people. Ultimately, it is also important to note that this project is not only improving the quality of water in the canals and managing the different waste streams generated in the town, it can also be instrumental in generating jobs and create opportunities for the youth to get involved in planning their towns. More on this will be covered in the next week's lecture.